Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Unwritten, Reinvent Tomorrow. Written by author Jack Delosa and read by Jack Delosa and Edwina Wren. This one's for Dad. These pages are born from the trees of the seeds you planted. There is a voice that doesn't use words. Listen. Rumi.
Foreword. I still recall getting the email from my agent about speaking at a conference called Unconvention. Immediately, my interest was piqued. Really? It's called Unconvention? I love it. Before I'd really looked into it, I knew I was already in. I mean, unconventional is kind of my middle name. So why would I investigate any further? Way too conventional. The first thing I noticed about Jack was his ease with everyone in the room. We're out the back in the green room with a bunch of awesome Motley Crue speakers, who all had something to say. He seemed very relaxed and intent on listening to whoever was speaking at the time. I actually had no idea that he was the one in charge. He was far too relaxed to be that person. Once I realised my error, my impressed barometer went up further. Great guy. Having now done a tour with Jack and worked alongside him, I know that he lives his life as his message to the world, and Unwritten is his way of capturing it. This message resonates deeply with me, with those who work alongside him, and, of course, with his audience. It's real and it's raw. It cuts straight to the truth, because Jack speaks from experience. You don't learn this kind of stuff sitting in a classroom or in a library. Sure, you can read about it and hypothesize all you like, but the real learning is always in the action. Jack's insights into OPRs, other people's rules, are pertinent to how we all live our lives. I love a good acronym. JFDI has long been my calling card. How many of us have been brought down by OPRs throughout our lives, especially when they're handed to us almost as a rite of passage within our family or close circle? OPRs can all too easily become entrenched ways of thinking, and the crazy thing is that many of these concepts have gone completely untested by the thinker. A clear-cut case of, but we've always done it like this. Philosophy is my thing. Socrates' The Unexamined Life is Not Worth Living resonates throughout this book, so Jack certainly gets us thinking and examining all our assumptions. Check in. You have the ability to respond to your life any way you wish. It's the way in which you respond to what the universe serves you that will define you. Not what you say about yourself, not what others say about you. What will define you is your action. Respond. Ability. Responsibility. Unwritten is the perfect guide to taking responsibility for who you are and, in a very real sense, as Jack says, to building the world around you. Michelle Bridges.
Introduction. Reinvent tomorrow. Whatever you do in life may seem insignificant to you, but it's important you do it, because no one else will. Mahatma Gandhi. It starts off as a whisper. A feeling from within hints ever so gently that you may be destined for something more. Normal isn't you. The traditional life is not who you are. When you dare to pay attention to the whisper, it grows slightly louder to tell you that you can do something great, something that matters. Soon you're walking along a different path, one that will be awe-inspiring, that will challenge you to become more of yourself. This is a path where the outward journey and the doing will always perfectly reflect the inner journey of your being. Your life's work is now an extension of who you are. I'm talking about entrepreneurship, and I don't just mean running your own business, although that is certainly one expression of it, but rather any form of taking ownership of your life and creating something that doesn't yet exist, be it a business, a career, or anything of which you are proud. Regardless of what flavor of entrepreneurship you pursue, when what you do is fueled by who you are, you will do your life's best work. Entrepreneurship is not a rational decision. To be somebody treading an unbeaten path towards a dream unfulfilled is not something we one day wake up, weigh up, and decide to do. It is more than that. It is who we are. We do not walk such a challenging path because it gives us something to do. We walk it because it reflects who we are here to be. The reason we heard the whisper when so many don't is that it resonated with the deepest part of us. Over many months or maybe many years or decades, everyone's different. We became more dissatisfied with the traditional way of life, and the whisper grew louder. Day by day, it intensified until it became a roar we could no longer ignore. It was at that point where we decided to live a life that wasn't governed by what was safe or tried or proven, but by our own unique sense of purpose. In this sense, entrepreneurship is a response to a higher calling. I'm not a religious person, however, I am a spiritual person. I think even the most pragmatic among us realize that there's more to who we are and the world around us than what the naked eye can see. For me, spirituality is about exploring our consciousness and our essence beyond our physicality. In this sense, I view the world and our place in it through a very spiritual lens. I believe that we are not human beings having a spiritual experience, but spiritual beings having a human experience. I believe that God is all of us and that we create ourselves and our world. I believe we are each capable of becoming more. To live a life that aligns with and honors our higher selves is to live an extraordinary life. And I am fully, absolutely, with every cell in my body, happy for you to believe the same thing or believe something different. We make far too many judgments, and I think that right and wrong is a very shallow paradigm through which to view the world. I believe that fully recognizing our own truths and living in accordance with them while encouraging others to do the same is the next step in our evolution. Entrepreneurship is a spiritual endeavor because at its essence, it is about creation. What starts out as nothing more than a compelling feeling in our heart and an inspired thought in our mind soon grows into something real. We talk about it with someone else, we share it, we dream about it, love it, wrestle with it, cry with it, and soon enough we begin to act on it and live with it. What was initially an intangible seed planted inside us soon becomes something very real, something people can touch, interact with, and use in their everyday lives. As it grows further, it reaches out into the world, touching the lives of many, even employing others who want to contribute to the journey. What was once the seed of an idea is now giving others the opportunity to do their life's best work. There is immense joy in finding others who are passionate about a vision that you now share. If they are the right people, they will do things they once thought impossible, each becoming a person they had never envisaged. Their entire life changes because they are part of a mission that has grown into something meaningful, something real. Yesterday it was a thought, and today, through a whole lot of hard work and a little bit of magic, it exists. To me, entrepreneurship mirrors life. It magnifies our experience. It is the path we walk on our quest to becoming the best version of ourselves. It is us experiencing what we are capable of and what we can contribute to the world. When work doesn't feel like work, we stop worrying about work-life balance because we've achieved work-life harmony. The two are no longer competing forces, but rather different colours that make up the landscape of our lives. We have not lost ourselves in our work. We have found ourselves in our quest. Life, like entrepreneurship, is a constant process of creation. Through our thoughts, words, and deeds, we are constantly creating who we are and, in a very real sense, creating the world around us, every inch of it. And it all starts from within. For me, the purpose of life is to consciously create who you want to be and the contribution you want to make. This is a book that examines timeless principles to enable you to do just that. It is for those who recognize they can create, who recognize that life is led by choice and not by chance. It is for those who dream of things that never were and who want to change things for the better. It is for those who see how malleable the world truly is and recognize that they are already shaping it. It is for those who realize the world only changes as we do. We all leave a legacy, whether it be through the upbringing of a great family, the growth of a veggie patch, the way in which we touch the lives of others, the establishment of a business, or large-scale societal change. Every life shifts the world in some small or large way. Legacy cares not for scale. This is not a book about breadth, but rather about depth. It's less about how far-reaching your influence is and more about ensuring that whatever you do is a representation of who you truly are. Mahatma Gandhi said of legacy, "Whatever you do in life may seem insignificant to you, but it's important you do it because no one else will." This is not a book about making money, although I don't see making money as a bad thing. With money, intention grows and influence amplifies. This is not a book primarily about business, although business can be an incredibly effective vehicle to carry one's vision into the world. This is not a book about becoming the next Nelson Mandela or Oprah Winfrey. Much can be learned from their stories, but to copy these people is to not learn from them. This is a book about becoming more of you, about continuously growing out of and into your best self. It's a book of unconventional wisdom for living a life on purpose. It contains stories that will shed light on how you can shape the world around you and be an example for those who want to do the same. When enough of us do so, we can reinvent tomorrow. Part 1. History. Chapter 1. The Greats of History. In testing the boundaries of human capabilities and technologies, we are standing on the shoulders of giants. Yesterday, we fell short. Sir Richard Branson. On the 31st of October 2014, Virgin Galactic's Spaceship 2 embarked from the Mojave Air and Spaceport on a flight that would test its new rocket engine and fuel. Piloted by 43-year-old Peter Sebold and his 39-year-old co-pilot Michael Alsbury, the space plane took off under its White Knight 2 carrier aircraft. Just 10 years earlier in 2004, Sir Richard Branson founded Virgin Galactic with the vision of making space travel accessible to everyone. Owning 400 companies across the Virgin Group empire, Branson has been knighted at Buckingham Palace for services to entrepreneurship and has an estimated net worth of $5 billion. Today, he has a strong focus on philanthropy and space travel. Among Virgin Galactic's ambitions are to establish the first hotel in space and to run a 2-hour commercial flight from London to Sydney by traveling outside the Earth's atmosphere. At an altitude of 50,000 feet, Spaceship 2 broke away from White Knight 2 and fired its new engine as planned. 9 seconds after ignition, the tail booms of the space plane unexpectedly began to swing upwards, increasing the drag as it accelerated. 2 seconds later, Spaceship 2 began to disintegrate mid-flight. Peter Sebold was thrust from the craft, ejecting his parachute and returning to Earth with serious injuries. Co-pilot Michael Alsbury tragically lost his life in the crash. The team of 400 Virgin Galactic staff watched on from the spaceport as they witnessed the shattering of a decade of hope, only to quickly learn that they had also lost the life of one of their close friends and colleagues, Michael Alsbury. This was an incredibly sad day for Virgin Galactic. The team of scientists and engineers had worked tirelessly to test the boundaries of human possibility while doing everything in their power to ensure the safety of the brave test pilots. The world's media immediately turned its attention to Virgin Galactic and its founder, Sir Richard Branson. What had happened? Who was to blame? What would Branson do now? On that day in October 2014, I was on my way to visit Branson on Necker Island. I was part of a small group of people invited to spend time on Necker with Richard. As we were flying in, he was of course now heading out to California to meet with the family of Michael Alsbury and his team of 400, to mourn with them and to work out what to do next. Branson spent a day in California at the Mojave Spaceport, taking the time to console everyone who was affected, to offer his counsel, and to get a feel for the resolve of the team in the wake of such an accident. Upon his return to Necker Island the next day, I noticed he was visibly upset from the events of the previous 2 days. When we asked him why he came back to Necker to see us, he simply replied, "Because I said I would." A small group of us sat with Branson in the Temple House, a room he had purposefully built for a non-governmental organisation called the Elders, which he had initiated in 2007. The Elders brings together 12 of the most influential and revered people in the world to tackle the planet's biggest challenges and to help resolve major conflicts from their unique platform of political independence. Members of the Elders have at various times included Nelson Mandela, Kofi Annan, and Jimmy Carter, the 39th President of the United States. The Temple House is a beautiful building constructed with 12 sides, one for each member of the Elders. We all appreciated the importance of the special room in which we were gathered. Branson sat in his board shorts, feet up on his coffee table, talking to us about what had happened and what he had been through over the last 2 days. "It was important I went there," he said. "It's important that as leaders we front up to any sort of tragedy. It was important for me to speak to the family of the test pilot who we lost and be with the team." He went on to explain that it was essential for him to feel how everyone was. The clear picture he gained of what had happened and how everyone felt about it gave him the knowledge and the confidence to decide on their next steps. They needed to know that the space program would continue, that what they had given a good chunk of their lives for would not be for nothing. And then, as his voice started to waver and his eyes filled with tears from thinking about the 400 people he obviously cared deeply for, he finished, "They needed to know they weren't going to lose their jobs." To sit with one of the greatest business leaders of all time in the midst of the largest crisis of his career was eye-opening for me because it revealed much of Branson's humanity. Throughout that week, Branson was not only excusing himself from conversations to focus on phone calls from the regulatory bodies involved in the crash investigation, but was also finding himself the focus of the world's media. Speculative journalism meant that headlines were being splashed across the likes of CNN, the New York Times, and the UK Telegraph. "Virgin Galactic crash. Don't let more die," Richard Branson told. "Branson should stick to mobile phones," says expert. "Branson spaceship explosion, the missed warnings." It's important to note that all the news stories had come out before the National Transportation Safety Board, the NTSB, had released any findings on the cause of the accident. While the NTSB was still investigating, Branson and Virgin Galactic could not publicly comment on what had happened due to any discussion being classified as speculation. While Branson and his team had to follow due process, the media did not, and they went on saying whatever they wanted, pointing the finger and being as radical as they liked without fear of any repercussions. Branson would later remark, "We found it uncomfortable over the weekend when so many self-proclaimed experts in the UK came out saying there had been an explosion. We're pleased the investigators came out and categorically denied that." The next day, after sitting across from Branson over lunch as he and I discussed what's wrong with traditional education and what needs to happen for it to improve.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.